In this video, we're going to take a tour of the human endocrine system, starting with the head. So the endocrine system is the chemical communication system of the body. The endocrine system is the body's main system for internal chemical regulation. It's the body's chemical communication system. And it works through the production of hormones. Hormones are regulatory chemicals produced by the body that affect specific sites in the body. Any of the structures that produce hormones are known as endocrine glands. And so, when we look at some of the endocrine glands and some of the hormones they produce, we see that there are many of them. There are endocrine glands in the brain, endocrine glands in the neck, endocrine glands in the abdomen, and even the gonads are endocrine glands as well. We'll be looking at some of these endocrine glands through this tour. So we're going to start our tour at the top of the body, at the head. The hypothalamus is the main control center of the endocrine system. As a part of the brain, the hypothalamus receives information from the nervous system and sends out appropriate responses. Directly adjacent to the hypothalamus is a structure known as the pituitary gland. The pituitary gland receives signals directly from the hypothalamus. The pituitary gland consists of two parts, a posterior lobe and an anterior lobe. In this case, the term anterior means closer to the front of the body, or closer to the face, whereas posterior is closer to the back of the body, or in this case, closer to the back of the skull. The posterior lobe of the pituitary stores and secretes hormones that were made in the hypothalamus. Meaning the posterior lobe doesn't really make hormones on its own. Instead, it releases the hormones that had been made by the hypothalamus. ADH, or antidiuretic hormone, a hormone which controls the activity of the kidneys, is an example of one of these hormones released by the posterior lobe of the pituitary. The anterior lobe of the pituitary synthesizes its own hormones. These include things like follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. These are gonadotropins, which stimulate the gonads to release their sex hormones and also play a role in triggering things like puberty. Prolactin is another hormone made by the anterior lobe of the pituitary, and this stimulates milk production in mammals. Another hormone made by the anterior lobe of the pituitary is human growth hormone. Now, growth hormone will have a broad effect on the body. Growth hormone, or GH, it's produced in the anterior pituitary, and its target are the bones and muscles of the body. Here we'll see a case where overproduction or underproduction of this hormone at different stages of an individual's life will end up impacting their overall body size and body plan. Gigantism is a condition where excess growth hormone is produced and released during childhood. Acromegaly is an overproduction of growth hormone in adulthood. Now, the difference between the two: if growth hormone is produced in excessive amounts during childhood, before the long bones have had a chance to ossify, this individual will be incredibly tall. Overproduction of growth hormone after the long bones have ossified, will still result in some growth, but really the growth we'll see will be primarily in the hands and feet, facial features such as the chin and the nose and the ears. Dwarfism, on the other hand, is a condition in which there's an underproduction of growth hormone. So here we see some individuals which have these different types of diseases caused by an over or underproduction of growth hormone. The next stop on our tour of the endocrine system is going to be the neck. In the neck, we have our thyroid gland. The thyroid gland is located just under the larynx or the voice box. The thyroid gland produces several hormones involved in controlling oxygen consumption, metabolism, and development. The thyroid gland also produces a hormone known as calcitonin. Calcitonin will help regulate the calcium levels in the blood. Hypothyroidism is a condition in which there is too little thyroid hormone produced. This can result from a dietary deficiency of iodine or from a defective thyroid gland. Now, iodine is needed for the production of certain types of thyroid hormones. And if an individual does not receive enough of this trace nutrient in their diet, it can cause the swelling of their thyroid gland, known as a goiter, along with the underproduction of thyroid hormone. It's for this reason that you see in most developed countries, trace amounts of iodine are added to the table salt. And this is why some of the salt is labeled as being iodized. Conversely, hyperthyroidism is an overproduction of thyroid hormones. This can be caused when there is too much thyroid hormone in the blood. One of the consequences of hyperthyroidism could be Graves' disease, which is an autoimmune disease. Again, a condition where the body's immune system starts attacking its own self proteins. Now, directly adjacent to the thyroid gland, in fact, embedded on the back of it, is the parathyroid gland. The parathyroid glands are four disc-shaped glands embedded on the back of the thyroid. The parathyroid gland produces a hormone that also controls calcium homeostasis. Calcitonin and parathyroid hormone have opposite effects when it comes to the control of calcium level in the blood. For this reason, these two hormones are said to be antagonists. Here in this diagram, the thickness of the red circuit represents the calcium level in the blood, with an intermediate thickness at the top being how much calcium there should be in the blood. If the blood calcium level starts to drop, this will be detected by the brain, and a message will be sent to the parathyroid glands that they need to produce PTH, or parathyroid hormone. The activity of PTH is actually going to tell the kidneys that it needs to absorb more calcium, preventing that calcium from being released from the body. It will also activate vitamin D within the intestines, causing more calcium to be absorbed from the foods that we eat. A message will also be sent to the bones to release extra calcium stores that they have. These three activities will all increase the amount of calcium in the blood, bringing us back to that set point. Once we've returned to that set point, the production of parathyroid hormone stops. So in this way, it's acting in negative feedback loop. Now conversely, if we have a whole bunch of calcium in our diet, well then, the thyroid gland will release the hormone calcitonin. Calcitonin will stimulate the deposition of calcium in the bones. It will also tell the kidneys that we have too much calcium and that more of that calcium should be flushed from the body in the urine. This will bring the blood calcium level back down to that set point and the production of calcitonin will stop. Both of these hormones, even though they're antagonists, they are used by the body to help us maintain homeostasis. We'll continue our tour of the endocrine system in our next video. See you in the next video.